You're watching Classic TV on Wayback Machine 1. Subscribe today.
Classic TV.
Wayback
Machine 1.
Wayback Machine 1.
In London, the accomplished Prince Florizel of Bohemia gained the affection of all classes by the seduction of his manner and by a well-considered generosity. Now and then, when he fell into a low humor, he would summon his confidant and master of the horse, Colonel Gerard, and bid him prepare himself for a night of adventure to be undertaken incognito.
There, Your Highness. It's finished. Name me.
Let me see, Gerard. I have it. I suggest you assume the character of a decayed gentleman of the press. Mr. Alfred Hammersmith, shall we call him?
Alfred Hammersmith, at your service.
And now tell me, Colonel, in what role would you cast me?
You could be a shady doctor or a disbarred member of the legal profession.
I prefer the latter. I know more of law than of pills. I shall call myself Mr. Theophilus Good, ex-Queen's Counsel, etc. Now let us drink to whatever the night may bring forth. Here's to the death of boredom.
And Your Highness's safety.
I don't think I want to drink to that. Danger and adventure rarely go hand in hand with safety.
May I respectfully remind Mr. Good that he is the heir to a throne. That limits the risks that Your Highness should run.
Gerard, how many times have you uttered that warning?
I've lost count, sir.
And have I ever heeded it?
You constantly disregard it, sir.
And I shall do the same tonight. So cease talking like a timid lady-in-waiting, or you'll dampen our evening.
Oysters.
Alfred, you're trying to be funny. What do you think an oyster bar serves, you prunes?
How many oysters have you got?
Well, like a duck. I don't know. I ain't counted them. 6 barrels full. That's 600 yards. I suppose you want to buy the lot?
That's exactly what I do want to do.
Really? You ain't serious.
As serious as the dead.
But you can't eat oysters by the hundred.
I don't want to eat them. I want to buy them. I'll pay for them, and you can feed them to your customers gratis.
Sure. You'll have to park up 20 quid at least.
I'll give you 30. There you are. 6 5-pound notes.
Well, strike me dead. Listen, ladies and gents. Anybody bought any oysters?
You honor me, sir?
Before I accept a gift, I'd like to know the spirit in which it's offered.
In the spirit of mockery.
Mockery? Of what?
Myself and life.
In that case, I readily accept, but on one condition, that you join my friend and myself over a bottle of champagne.
I like you, sir. It will be a privilege to drink with you.
Send over a bottle of champagne and glasses for three. My name is Mr. Good, and this is my friend, Mr. Alfred Hammersmith. And your name, sir?
Shall we say, Mr. X? My real name I shall keep to myself, as you have done.
Would it be an impertinence to ask the reason for your feeding succulent mollusks to this rabble?
Not at all. Only 2 months ago, I met a young lady with whom I fell madly in love. She spurned me. Since then, she has made a good marriage. And I have tried to bury my sadness in increasing my expenditures. The purchase of those oysters was a last and futile gesture. Now nothing at all remains of my capital.
Isn't it odd that we three should have met by the merest chance and be in the same condition?
So you two are penniless?
Oh, and worse, disgraced. The devil himself must have brought us together for this last carouse.
Last carouse? Then you two wish to put an end to life?
Well, yes. Only a moment ago we were planning just such a final indulgence.
This is indeed a miraculous coincidence.
It's more than that. It's a sign. Why put off the fatal moment any longer, Hammersmith? Let it be tonight and at once, all three together. Such a hapless trio should go arm in arm into the halls of Pluto.
Agreed. Let us drink to that.
And now as to method. Have you any suggestions?
Definitely. Here is all I have left in the world. 4 10-pound notes. And each of you muster a similar amount.
I'm utterly without funds. But Mr. Hammersmith may be able to oblige.
I have 80 pounds.
Why?
Then we are indeed fortunate. 40 pounds is the entrance fee to the Suicide Club.
The Suicide Club? In the devil's name, what's that?
Death's private door. The Suicide Club was organized to accommodate those who wish to shuffle off this mortal coil without scandal. You gentlemen truly are tired of life as you say you are. I can introduce you at a meeting of the club tonight.
Sounds just what we've been looking for, eh, Hammersmith?
Oh, yes, indeed.
A unique, unknown method of departure. Fascinating. Mr. X, we accept your gracious offer. You may lead us to death's private door.
Destination.
Number 13.
There is still time, Mr. Good, to turn back.
I'm not the man to change my mind.
So be it.
Pronounce the password.
Regeat Rex Mortis.
Enter. You gentlemen?
We are anxious to become members of your club.
Reasons?
We have no use for further life.
Oh, come, come, sir. We must have more than that. Frankly, I would send you packing were you not with this young gentleman who is known to me. Many of his friends are sleeping happily in the tomb due to my organization.
What exactly do you want?
Data as to why you've been brought to this, shall we say, grave decision? This is strictly for my records, you understand. While we are tacit as to moral judgments, we are also meticulous in the extreme.
Very laudable. Very well, Mr. President. My friend and I cheated at cards. It was a joint plan that miscarried. We were caught and exposed. Result, we're at the end of our financial tether. No other course but self-destruction is open to us.
Ah. Well, that is much better. In fact, I think I can conscientiously say that it qualifies you. But, you can pay the boatman the necessary toll.
Give him the money, Hammersmith.
Now, that seems to be correct. Now, gentlemen, before I accept this, there is the little matter of an oath which you must swear.
An oath? Demanding what from us?
Strict obedience to our rules.
What are the rules?
You'll be told after you sign the oath.
That seems to be most one-sided. I demand to know to what I'm committing myself.
Those are my conditions, sir. If you and your friend have any qualms, the door back to the outside world is still open to you.
If For my part, that door is closed forever. Very well, Mr. President. I accept your conditions. Let me read this oath. Any man who forfeited an oath so awful would never have a rag of honor left to him.
Nor could he face his maker on the judgment day.
Nevertheless, I will sign.
And I. Gentlemen, you put me to shame. Give me that pen.
Dear friends, you are at last in sight of that undiscovered country from whose bourne no traveler returns. Follow me, gentlemen. I shall introduce you to our oldest member. It is his function to tell you exactly how you will die.
And now the second act of our suspense story, The Suicide Club.
I apologize for breaking in on your reveries, Mr. Malthus, but we have three new members. They wish for information.
Then they have come to the right source, Mr. President. Will you please be seated?
If you will forgive me, gentlemen, I have my duties as a host to attend to.
A charming man. A genius in his way. Now, what is it you wish to know?
Everything. How this organization works.
It is the perfection of simplicity. A member who comes here in search of death, like yourself, returns every evening until fortune favors him.
That phrase indicates some game of chance.
Quite correct, my dear sir. Cards. The president shuffles and deals, and when the game is over, he makes the necessary arrangements. Sometimes I believe him to be inspired.
Indeed.
Yes, inspired. Doubtless you remember a celebrated case 6 months ago of a certain nobleman who was accidentally poisoned in a chemist's shop. That was one of his lesser achievements, but how simple, how safe.
You astonish me. Do you mean to say that that unfortunate gentleman was a member of this club?
Yes, my dear sir, that fortunate gentleman sat in the very chair where you sit now the night before he died.
But how was it decided that he was to be the happy victim?
What game is played? The president uses an ordinary pack of cards. He deals one card to each member until two have appeared. The ace of spades, that is the card of death. The ace of clubs, that designates who is to be the executioner.
You mean that one member destroys another?
Yes, that removes the danger of suicide. Also, its stigma. Thanks to the brilliant mind of the president, no ace of clubs has ever been indicted.
Why, this very night, fate may decide that one of us may destroy the other.
It's infamous, infamous! But infinitely exciting. If, as in my case, chance lengthens your life, you will appreciate that this game combines all the thrills of the gambling table, a duel, and a Roman amphitheater. All amusements will seem vapid and insipid. Ah, but you may judge for yourselves. I see the game is about to begin.
Attention, gentlemen. The cards await you.
May yet not be too late to make our escape.
Come, we can play like gentlemen, however high the stakes.
As is usual with our game, gentlemen, we will preserve the solemn silence.
Now, you and I and Mr. Malthus will talk together and make the final arrangements. Wait till everyone is gone. Gentlemen, I bid you good evening. We shall meet again tomorrow night.
Morning, about 2 a.m., Mr. Bartholomew Malthus, 16 Chepstow Place, Westbourne Grove, fell over the upper parapet in Trafalgar Square. Death was instantaneous. Mr. Malthus was known to be subject to occasional attacks of paralysis. It is thought that his fall may have been caused by another seizure.
That poor young Mr. X. If ever there was a man with a soul in hell, it must be his.
Last night he was as innocent as you or I. This morning there's blood on his hands.
When I think of the president of that vile society battening and battening on the weakness of distorted minds, Gerard, never in my entire life have I felt myself so shaken with rage. And I vow before God I'll make that jackal pay for his iniquities.
I could go to the authorities, not without forfeiting your honor, Gerard. You, I, all the members have sworn an oath that few would dare to break. And what proof would there be? Remember, the president himself never lays a finger on his victims. No, Gerard, my mind's made up. Tonight, once more, I take my seat at the table of the Suicide Club.
Ah, my dear sir. My heartiest commendations. An excellent night's work. How grateful Mr. Malthus must be for your efficiency.
Grateful? Pray God, I draw the ace of spades tonight. If you could have heard the old man scream as he fell.
Oh, come, come, sir. You mustn't take it so personally. Think of yourself as a soldier. A unit in an army of death's familiars.
I can think of myself only as a murderer.
Gentlemen, doubtless the fall. A
are looking for you gentlemen who have reached us. Four of you. The odds are excitingly short.
Shall we begin?
Ah! It seems I spoke too soon. The odds will be 5-1. The fun is just about to begin, gentlemen.
Please excuse our being late, Mr. President. We were unable to find a conveyance. The streets are deserted. The fog is so dense that only the desperate are abroad tonight.
Unlucky gentlemen will leave as quickly as possible. I shall the sooner be able to conclude my business with the two lucky ones. I'm very happy to have met you, sir, and to be in a position to do you this trifling service. One thing, you cannot complain of delay. On the second evening, what a stroke of luck. You look a little sickish, sir. Most gentlemen do when it comes to the final moment.
What instructions have you for me, Mr. President?
They're very simple. You will make your way on foot down this alley to the Thames Embankment. You know the monument, Cleopatra's Needle?
Certainly.
You may or may not get that far. Whatever happens, you are to offer no resistance. That is one of the rules which you have sworn to obey. One thing I can promise you, it will be swift, sudden. That is all. Wait in the anteroom 5 minutes and then leave.
My thanks. You've saved me from the boredom of old age.
I wish you a pleasant stroll in the fog, sir. Now, sir, listen to my instruction carefully, but first, put this in your pocket. I am rather suspicious of our friend, Mr. Goods. I found it best to anticipate any difficulties. So please, listen to these instructions most carefully. You will leave by the rear exit. You will then proceed.
Gerard.
Gerard.
Mr. Hammersmith.
Friend Major Kilpatrick didn't give you too much of a drubbing, sir.
He saved me from a watery grave. Or worse. That scoundrel of a president mustn't go unpunished.
He won't, sir. This morning I talked to Sir William Warren, the chief of police. At the moment, the suicide club is surrounded. The president will be apprehended as he leaves. He will be arraigned and charged as being an accessory to the murder.
On what evidence?
On the written evidence in his own ledgers. I purloined them while he was signing your death warrant.
Magnificent, Gerard. That will surely convict him. Then it will be his turn to draw the ace of spades.
I shall call myself Mr. Theophilus Good, ex-Queen's Counsel, etc. Now let us drink to whatever the night may bring forth. Here's to the death of boredom.
And your Highness's safety.
I don't think I want to drink to that. Danger and adventure rarely go hand in hand with safety.
May I respectfully remind Mr. Good that he is the heir to a throne. That limits the risks that your Highness should run.
Gerard, how many times have you uttered that warning?
I've lost count, sir.
And have I ever heeded it?
You constantly disregard it, sir.
And I shall do the same tonight. So cease talking like a timid lady-in-waiting, or you'll dampen our evening.
Any oysters?
Edward, you're trying to be funny. What do you think an oyster bar serves, you prunes?
How many oysters have you got?
Oh, not a duck. I don't know. I ain't counted them. 6 barrels full. That's 600 odd. I suppose you want to buy the lot?
That's exactly what I do want to do.
Really? You ain't serious.
As serious as the dead.
But you can't eat oysters by the hundred.
I don't want to eat them. I want to buy them. I'll pay for them and you can feed them to your customers gratis.
Sure. You'll have to park up 20 quid at least.
I'll give you 30. There you are. 6 5-pound notes.
Stop me, please. Listen, ladies and gents. Anybody want any oysters?
You want to meet, sir?
Before I accept a gift, I'd like to know the spirit in which it's offered.
In the spirit of mockery.
Mockery? Of what?
Myself and life.
In that case, I readily accept, but on one condition, that you join my friend and myself over a bottle of champagne.
I like you, sir. It will be a privilege to drink with you.
Send over a bottle of champagne and glasses for three. My name is Mr. Good, and this is my friend, Mr. Alfred Hammersmith. And your name, sir?
Shall we say, Mr. X? My real name I shall keep to myself, as you have done.
Would it be an impertinence to ask the reason for your feeding succulent mollusks to this rabble?
Not at all. Only 2 months ago, I met a young lady with whom I fell madly in love. She spurned me. Since then, she has made a good marriage. And I have tried to bury...
Any man who forfeited an oath so awful would never have a rag of honor left to him.
Nor could he face his maker on the judgment day.
Nevertheless, I will find.
And I.
Gentlemen, you put me to shame. Give me that pen.
Dear friends, you are at last in sight of that undiscovered country from whose bourne no traveler returns. Follow me, gentlemen. I shall introduce you to our oldest member. This is functioned to tell you exactly how you will die.
The Suicide Club.
I apologize for breaking in on your reveries, Mr. Malthus, but we have three new members. They wish for information.
Then they have come to the right source, Mr. President. Will you please be seated?
If you will forgive me, gentlemen, I have my duties as a host to attend to.
A charming man. A genius in his way. Now, what is it you wish to know?
Everything. How this organization works.
It is the perfection of simplicity. A member who comes here in search of death, like yourself, returns every evening until fortune favors him.
That phrase indicates some game of chance.
Quite correct, my dear sir. Cards. The president shuffles and deals, and when the game is over, he makes the necessary arrangements. Sometimes.
As to why you've been brought to this, shall we say, grave decision? This is strictly for my records, you understand. While we are tacit as to moral judgments, we are also meticulous in the extreme.
Very laudable. Very well, Mr. President. My friend and I cheated at cards. It was a joint plan that miscarried. We were caught and exposed. Result, we're at the end of our financial tether. No other course but self-destruction is open to us.
Ah. Well, that is much better. In fact, I think I can conscientiously say that it qualifies you. But, you can pay the boatman the necessary toll.
Give him the money, Hammersmith.
Well, that seems to be correct. Now, gentlemen, before I accept this, there is the little matter of an oath which you must swear.
An oath? Demanding what from us?
Strict obedience to our rules.
What are the rules?
You'll be told after you sign the oath.
That seems to be most one-sided. I demand to know to what I'm committing myself.
Those are my conditions, sir. If you and your friend have any qualms, the door back to the outside world is still open to you.
For my part, that door is closed forever. Very well, Mr. President. I accept your conditions. Let me read this oath. Any man who forfeited an oath so awful would never have a rag of honor left to him.
Nor could he face his maker on the judgment day.
Nevertheless, I will sign.
And I.
Gentlemen, you put me to shame. Give me that pen.
Dear friends, you are at last in sight of that undiscovered country from whose bourne no traveler returns. Follow me, gentlemen. I shall introduce you to our oldest member. Is his function to tell you exactly?
Dr. X. My real name I shall keep to myself, as you have done.
Would it be an impertinence to ask the reason for your feeding succulent mollusks to this rabble?
Not at all. Only 2 months ago, I met a young lady with whom I fell madly in love. She spurned me. Since then, she has made a good marriage. And I have tried to bury my sadness in increasing my expenditures. The purchase of those oysters was a last and futile gesture. Now nothing at all remains of my capital.
Isn't it odd that we three should have met by the merest chance and be in the same condition?
So you two are penniless?
Oh, and worse, disgraced. The devil himself must have brought us together for this last carouse.
Last carouse?
Then you too wish to put an end to life?
Well, yes.
Only a moment ago we were planning just such a final indulgence.
This is indeed a miraculous coincidence.
It's more than that. It's a sign. Why put off the fatal moment any longer, Hammersmith? Let it be tonight and at once, all three together. Such a hapless trio should go arm in arm into the halls of Pluto.
Agreed. Let us drink to that.
Now as to method. Have you any suggestions?
Definitely. Here is all I have left in the world. 4 10-pound notes. And each of you muster a similar amount.
I'm utterly without funds. But Mr. Hammersmith may be able to oblige.
I have 80 pounds. Why?
Then we are indeed fortunate. 40 pounds is the entrance fee to the Suicide Club.
The Suicide Club? In the devil's name, what's that?
Death's private door. The Suicide Club was organized to accommodate those who wish to shuffle off this mortal coil without scandal. You gentlemen truly are tired of life as you say you are. I can introduce you at a meeting of the club tonight.
Sounds just what we've been looking for, eh, Hammersmith?
Oh, yes, indeed.
A unique, unknown method of departure. Fascinating. Mr. X, we accept your gracious offer. You may lead us to death's private door.
Destination.
Number 13.
There is still time, Mr. Good, to turn back.
I'm not the man to change my mind.
So be it.
Pronounce the password.
Regular Bohemia gained the affection of all classes by the seduction of his manner and by a well-considered generosity. Now and then, when he fell into a low humor, he would summon his confidant and master of the horse, Colonel Gerard, and bid him prepare himself for a night of adventure to be undertaken incognito.
There, Your Highness. It's finished. Name me.
Let me see, Gerard.
I have it. I suggest you assume the character of a decayed gentleman of the press, Mr. Alfred Hammersmith, shall we call him?
Alfred Hammersmith, at your service.
And now tell me, Colonel, in what role would you cast me?
You could be a shady doctor, or a disbarred member of the legal profession.
I prefer the latter. I know more of law than of pills. I shall call myself Mr. Theophilus Good, ex-Queen's Counsel, etc. Now let us drink to whatever the night may bring forth. Here's to the death of boredom.
And Your Highness's safety.
I don't think I want to drink to that. Danger and adventure rarely go hand in hand with safety.
May I respectfully remind Mr. Good that he is the heir to a throne. That limits the risks that Your Highness should run.
Gerard, how many times have you uttered that warning?
I've lost count, sir.
And have I ever heeded it?
You constantly disregard it, sir.
And I shall do the same tonight. So cease talking like a timid lady-in-waiting, or you'll dampen our evening.
Your order, please.
Have you any oysters?
Edward, you're trying to be funny. What do you think an oyster bar serves, you prunes?
How many oysters have you got?
Well, not a duck. I don't know. I ain't counted them. Full. That's $600. I suppose you want to buy the lot?
That's exactly what I do want to do.
Really? You ain't serious.
As serious as the dead.
But you can't eat oysters by the hundred.
I don't want to eat them. I want to buy them. I'll pay for them and you can feed them to your customers gratis.
Sure. You'll have to park up 20 quid at least.
I'll give you 30. There you are. 6 5-pound notes.
Listen, ladies and gents. Anybody want any oysters?
Oh, my God.
Now, then, please. Get back to this, 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 please.
honor me, sir?
Before I accept a gift, I'd like to know the spirit in which it's offered.
In the spirit of mockery.
Bonds. You are at last in sight of that undiscovered country from whose bourne no traveler returns. Follow me, gentlemen. I shall introduce you to our oldest member. This is functioned to tell you exactly how you will die.
And now the second act of our suspense story, The Suicide Club.
I apologize for breaking in on your reveries, Mr. Malthus, but we have three new members. They wish for information.
Then they have come to the right source, Mr. President. Will you please be seated?
If you will forgive me, gentlemen, I have my duties as a host to attend to.
A charming man. A genius in his way. Now, what is it you wish to know?
Everything. How this organization works.
It is the perfection of simplicity. A member who comes here in search of death, like yourself, returns every evening until fortune favors him.
That phrase indicates some game of chance.
Quite correct, my dear sir. Cards. The president shuffles and deals, and when the game is over, he makes the necessary arrangements. Sometimes I believe him to be inspired.
Indeed.
Yes, inspired. Doubtless you remember a celebrated case 6 months ago of a certain nobleman who was accidentally poisoned in a chemist's shop. That was one of his lesser achievements, but how simple, how safe.
You astonish me. Do you mean to say that that unfortunate gentleman was a member of this club?
Yes, my dear sir, that fortunate gentleman sat in the very chair where you sit now the night before he died.
But how was it decided that he was to be the happy victim?
What game is played? The president uses an ordinary pack of cards. He deals one card to each member until two have appeared. The ace of spades, that is the card of death. The ace of clubs, that designates who.